Hi there. Today I'm doing a gameplay video and I'm going to be playing the game Universe Sandbox. I've done a few videos like this on my channel in the past, but it has been a little while since I've done it. The vibe of the video is going to hopefully be quite relaxing. We're going to have a little tour of the universe and have a look at some stars, things like that, and hopefully you will learn some things along the way, because I'll give you some commentary on the science that we're talking about, and so maybe it'll be a bit of a relaxing learning session for you. So to start off with, I want to open up a simulation of the nearest and brightest stars. We start off with our sun in the middle here, but as we zoom out or rotate around, we can see all of these nearest and brightest stars, and they've got their labels on them. You can see some of them around here. So we're just swimming around in the stars at the moment. Now there's one star in particular that I want to try and find, and let's see if we can get there. The star that I'm trying to find is one of the brightest in the night sky, or at least it usually is. It's usually, I think, the 10th brightest in the night sky. But you might have heard at the moment, it's been in the news, that our good friend over there, I can see him in the background, Betelgeuse, or as some say, Betelgeuse, and perhaps I'll say Betelgeuse for the rest of this video, he has been dimming lately. So let's go and visit, shall we? Let's fly over to this system here. So Betelgeuse is, like I said, one of the brightest stars in the sky usually, and it's in the constellation Orion. If you ever see Orion, you can see it with your naked eye at night. You might know sort of the shape of the body of Orion, and Betelgeuse is right on the shoulder, or actually maybe the armpit, as the name Betelgeuse comes from an Arabic word for the armpit of Orion. You can even see here on this little simulation that the star is fairly red. It's got this kind of rusty sort of color compared to, you know, even the stars in the background. They're a bit more blue or white even. A very kind of reddish star. And that is something that you can also kind of observe with your naked eye. And a lot of scientists throughout history have noted that this is a very red star. However, back 2000 years ago, Chinese astronomers in their records, they spoke about Betelgeuse as well, the same star. They commented on it being a bit of a yellow color, and it seemed to not match up to what we see today. And it actually could make sense that maybe 2,000 years ago, this star was in a yellow supergiant phase, and perhaps it has actually gone more red since then. Betelgeuse was created in one of the stellar nurseries in Orion, although it has now been ejected. It's kind of a runaway star off doing its own thing, and it is actually traveling really fast. So I think I read it's traveling at 30 kilometers per second, and it's ejecting a lot of stellar material, gas, and it's creating a bow shock around it. It would have been formed in a place where there was a lot of interstellar medium, the necessary gas and dust and things like that that you need to create stars. And a lot of the other famous stars of Orion would have probably been created in the same place. So let's get a feel for how big this star actually is. I will load up our solar system. Here we are, happily orbiting around the sun. Earth, there he goes. So what we're going to do is take the sun, and we're just going to replace it with Betelgeuse. I believe that what I'll need to do is to first delete our sun. So sun, delete. And while the simulation is paused, I will go and find Betelgeuse and put it in the sun's place. I think we've got the center lined up there. We'll place the star. And I think it's rather evident that we're going to have a problem here. As you see, Betelgeuse is so large that the giant that it is, it's completely encompassing the orbits of Venus, Mercury, Mars, Earth, They're all now within the star. Looks like Jupiter survived though. Jupiter's out here, now orbiting around Betelgeuse. Everything else inside of Jupiter has already been completely swamped by the star. And this would be our new solar system if Betelgeuse was our star. So we've got Neptune out here, Uranus, Saturn. Oh, Saturn survived too. So let's run the simulation and see how the orbits of these planets that remain would be affected. I can see some little dots in there. I guess that is the asteroid belt. There goes Saturn flying in. I can see some little flare-ups as planets and things hit the star. All right, so Saturn's gone, and Uranus, Neptune, all starting to now change their orbits as we've got this huge new mass in the solar system. So there we go, that gives us a bit of an idea of the size of this star. It is about 10 to 20 times the mass of the Sun. So that gives you, an understanding of why it's affecting the orbits the way that it is. Let's go and look at some more stars though, not just Betelgeuse. We'll come back to talking about Betelgeuse in a minute, but first let's remind ourselves of, just stellar evolution in general and the life cycles of stars. To do that, I'm going to load up a simulation of the nearest 400 stars. So here we are, these are our neighbours. This is our stellar neighborhood. It's quite beautiful when you move around and just see that we're really part of this big lattice, really, it looks like when you see it like this, of stars. And these are only the nearest ones, so there are much more out there that the simulation just hasn't been able to add. Let's zoom out, see as many as we can. There we go, there's our neighborhood. So what I really want to do is create a chart out of all these stars. So let's have a look at our options. I think they're currently about to arrange themselves by radius and create something that's a bit nonsensical. But what I really want is a chart, or we can do an HR diagram. So this is something you see when you're studying astronomy. The HR diagram, or the Hertzsprung-Russell diagrams in every astronomy textbook. But we've just created one here out of our nearest neighborhood of stars, and we can explore it a little bit. This diagram is essentially a plot between the absolute magnitude of a star. So if we imagine an axis on the y-axis, which is increasing in brightness as we get towards the top of the screen, and along the bottom of the screen, the axis would be color, or effectively the temperature of the star. If we have blue colors more towards the left, those are the hotter stars, higher temperature, and more towards the right of the screen we will have the orange or red stars, which are actually a cooler temperature. So let's see if we can zoom in a little here. We can see that a lot of the stars are along this kind of central line here, going up through the middle on a bit of a diagonal. Now that is the main sequence. So there's all of our stars in there. Our Sun will be somewhere in there as well. Probably about midway up, I would say. So that's the main sequence, and it's kind of just a tool in astronomy to be able to classify stars by plotting them on something like this, but to also understand where a star might be in its evolution or in its life cycle. So most stars would be on the main sequence, and stars spend most of their lives on the main sequence. This is the stage where they are burning fuel, they are fusing hydrogen into helium. Once a star has used up all of its hydrogen fuel, it would exit the main sequence and perhaps come up here like these stars. These would be our red giants and red supergiants. These stars would be of reasonably low temperature, but very high luminosity. So they're very bright stars, and they're nearing the end of their lives. Over here, off the main sequence, we have, if we can click on them, some blue giant stars. These are young and very hot stars. There's a bit of a saying in stellar astronomy relating to the lives of stars. Essentially, it is live fast and die young. That kind of refers to these stars here, these big stars with a lot of fuel to burn. They will burn that fuel very quickly because they need to, because of their size, they need to be burning a lot of fuel to kind of fight against this gravitational force that's kind of wanting them to collapse in on themselves. So to fight that, they need to burn their fuel really quickly. So in a kind of way that might go against what you'd expect, stars with more mass might actually live shorter lives and burn that mass up more quickly. The general life cycle of stars is, be born in a stellar nursery, come on to the main sequence and burn up your fuel. Then depending on your size, perhaps one of two things will happen to you. If you're an average sized star, you might burn up all your fuel and then become a red giant, expanding in size a lot and also expelling a lot of your material in a planetary nebula, which will go on to, be the material to form new stars. After that, your remains would be a white dwarf, maybe a star that would probably be down here on our HR diagram, something that's not very bright, but still quite hot. If you are a very massive star, however, you might become a red supergiant, and instead of just becoming a white dwarf, you might explode into a supernova, then becoming either a black hole or a new, very dense neutron star. So that's kind of our stellar evolution recovered there. And the reason that I just wanted to talk about it is because the star of this episode, Betelgeuse, he's been dimming recently, and we think that might be something to do with him coming towards the end of his life. So we want to understand what the life cycles of stars even are. I'm back here with our friend Betelgeuse, and it's interesting because in October last year, 2019, astronomers noticed that the star was dimming, and the dimming went on for quite a while. It's still dimmed now, and there's been observations that it has dimmed by a factor of 2.5 times, which is, quite a lot for a star. Although Betelgeuse is a known variable star, which means that its brightness does fluctuate a bit, so a little bit of dimming is actually not that abnormal, although this amount of dimming was quite out of the ordinary. So people were getting excited and thinking, does this mean that something, big is about to happen? Maybe Betelgeuse is about to go supernova. Maybe this is the end of its life. Well, why would dimming indicate that it's about to go supernova anyway? Wouldn't you expect it to be a lot brighter? Well, actually, the reason I found for that was that just before going supernova, when the star is at the end of its life, it would be ejecting a lot of material, and this material might be getting in between the star and us and absorbing a lot of its light, through extinction of the light. And so it's actually appearing dimmer because of the material that it is throwing off. Of course, when it would go supernova, that would be an extremely bright and, spectacular sight for us in the night sky. It would be as bright as the moon. Everyone has been quite excited for a while about this because Betelgeuse is expected to go supernova sometime, although the scientific estimates don't say that that will happen for at least 100,000 more years. So if it really was about to happen soon, it would be a little early, but it seems plausible that it could happen. But a study that was published quite recently, February 24th, said that the most likely explanation for the dimming was a large, amount of dust in the way, of circumstellar dust, which was absorbing some of the light. So let's see if we can simulate what would happen if Betelgeuse was to go supernova. And I think one of the ways I can do that, open up its properties and just change our solar mass in here to be 20 times that of the sun. Let's zoom out a little in anticipation and see what we get. I toggled the calculated radius on and off. and that has caused us to indeed make this star go supernova. So we can see this front here expanding out from the remnant. It says the Betelgeuse Nova remnant. And yeah, that is quite a pretty sight there. Just watching it expanding out. So this is what would be a really magnificent sight in our night sky if we got to see this. That's why some astronomers were kind of hopeful in a way that it would go supernova. It would be an amazing thing to be able to study with the technology that we have now. It's not something that we've ever been able to see that well before, or definitely be able to study in the kind of ways we would be able to if it happened today. So we've got this red glow, really large, all the way out here. Like I said, this would be as bright as the moon in our night sky, I believe, and would last for a couple of months as it slowly fades away. Betelgeuse, although it is a huge star, doesn't have enough mass to become a black hole after this, so we would be left with probably a neutron star at the core there, and that would be, I think, quite dim, so it would disappear from our night sky. I probably wouldn't hold your breath waiting for this to happen. By this stage, I think a lot of astronomers have accepted that maybe we do have to wait closer to the expected 100,000 years for this to happen, and maybe some dust just did get in our way and make it look a bit dimmer, and maybe it was also part of its just variable life cycle. But there's always a chance, and if anything, the idea that this could happen or the speculation around it means that, you know, when you go outside, you might want to just have a little look up at Orion and see if you can see Orion's shoulder, see if you can see Betelgeuse, and see if you think it's dimming. If you can notice that, that would be a pretty cool thing to see. If you've got a telescope, you might be a bit better placed, but even just with your naked eye as well, it might be a really fun way to just engage with astronomy. So thank you for coming on this little journey through the stars with me today, and I'll see you next time.